afternoon, evening, Calvary Chapel Concord.
Yeah.
Evening, yeah. You guys ready to worship?
Yeah.
Let's just bow our hearts before Him. Father, we just come to You, and Lord, we are thankful and grateful, Lord, for Your provision, and Lord, just for Your presence. Not P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S, but presence. That, Father, You so faithfully provide, You know, for us, Lord. We just, this evening, Lord, would ask God for just the direction of Your Holy Spirit. Father, just fill us to overflowing. That, Father, we might just receive from You direction, instruction. And Lord, not just come for a handout, but come to really, truly receive Your presence in this place, in our lives, in our very soul. Lord, forgive us and keep us, Lord, in the palm of Your hand. We love You so much, and we just want to be of one mind with You in the singleness of purpose and heart. So, Father, just bless our time together tonight. Draw us close to You, Lord, as we draw near to You. Bless us, we pray, not because we deserve it, Lord, but in spite of us, Lord. We love You. We thank You. We are in awe of You, Lord. And we ask these things that You would just direct us now. In Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Need a capo for this first one here. Lost or saved, find their way at the sound of Your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of Your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of Your great name. The enemy, He has to leave at the sound of Your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, You are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise Your great name. Strength at the sound of Your great name. Hungry souls receive grace at the sound of Your great name. Fatherless, they find their rest at the sound of Your great name. Sick are healed and the dead are raised at the sound of Your great name. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, my Savior, Defender, You are my King. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, my Savior, Defender, You are my King, Jesus. You are high and lifted up.
and all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Your great name, your great name. Stronger than the power of the grave, constant in the trial and the change, this one thing remains, this one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love, your love, and all.
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is God, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever. From rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. By the grace of God will carry on, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever you are faithful, forever you are strong, forever you are with us, forever. See the heck of your hand, galaxies spinning a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are so overwhelming. And I hear the sound of your voice, all at once it's a gentle and thundering noise. All that you are, it's so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run ashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. I know the power of your cross, forgiven and free, forever you'll be my God. All that you've done, so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your
are beautiful. You are beautiful. Oh God, there is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful. God, you are the most beautiful. You are wonderful. You are wonderful. Oh God, there is no one more wonderful. You are wonderful. God, you are the most wonderful. You are glorious. You are glorious. Oh God, there is no one more glorious. You are glorious. God, you are the most glorious. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. There's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is the cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet. I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Well, almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will be when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever. Forever worship you. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Na-na-na-na. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Na, na, na. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength.
We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he. Together we sing. anyone sing. Holy is the Lord
God
Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. And it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. Said it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. Said it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. Lord, it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. Together we sing. Everyone sing. God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory.
The earth is filled with His glory.
The earth is filled with His glory.
Yes, Lord. God, thank You so much. Your glory is all around us, Father God. Open our eyes to see. Open our ears to hear. You are so good, God. We worship You. We praise You. We adore You. We look forward to that day we get to walk with You in newness of life without any falsehood in us, Lord, without any sin. Father God, we thank You that You have removed that boundary, Father, through Jesus Christ's blood. We thank You, Jesus, so much for being that sacrifice. Thank You, Lord God, that You are a good shepherd, that You lead us by those still waters, that You are the one who's taking us home. Father God, we trust You. We love You. We bless You. Be glorified in us, we pray and ask in Jesus' precious name. And everyone said, amen. Amen.
Love one another, guys.
Okay, good evening, everybody. Evening. Yeah. Do you know what phrase in the Bible is said 365 times? The same phrase, 365 times. Yeah. Do not be afraid. So that's every day, you know, so 365 times. So do not be afraid. I was taking the motorhome up to Carson City, and they did something to the roads up there on the trucker side. They made grooves on it. And so I'm driving the motorhome up there about 70 miles an hour, and all of a sudden I lost it, and I'm going like this. Almost, my nephew is behind me, and he says, I thought you were going to go over the cliff. And I said, no. I said, the angels were looking out for me. They were pushing on both sides, getting me straight. Anyway, okay, the pastor's ready to go, so let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for another day. Thank you for the nice weather that we're having, and we do praise you and love you, and thank you for everything that you do for us. You're just so good to us. Please anoint our pastor today as he teaches us from your word, and we do give you all the glory because it's all about you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Okay, so keep in line with the direction we want to go with prayer. And we are opening it up to ladies too, but at the beginning of each service, there'll be one of these that go up on the screen. There may be two of them, depending on how far along we're getting. We want to expand it, but we don't want to expand it to the point where it takes over time that we need for the word. So we're looking and seeking for balance, and we're praying about how the Lord would want us to do it. But for now, basically I want one of you just to know this, no set thing. If the Lord lays it on your heart, stand up, read the verse first, pray the prayer, and then close the prayer in your own words. So let's go ahead and stand for Israel. And I'll have one of you guys pick and go.
Scripture reading, Matthew 5:9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. God, we ask that you grant strength and courage to those working for peace. May your Holy Spirit empower them to pursue your will. May they protect the innocent and put an end to evildoers. Pray that any action taken would not be prone to hatred or sin, but that they would rely on your guidance to do what is right. Please show them what you want them to do and how you want them to do it. Lord Jesus, please guide us all to just open up and show the peace and the love that you bring us to the world. Just have us be beacons of your light. And just bringing it out to the world. We thank you, Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. God bless you guys. Numbers is a good name for this book because it deals with the numbering of people. And we have a lot of repetition in here, which is a good thing you'll find out as we go along. But we know, what we do know is that Israel's being prepared to enter into the promised land. And so there's two censuses that are taken, one in the beginning and the other towards the end, counting the people. Why did he do this? Because the Lord is telling us through his book that there's to be accountability, or if you would, an accounting, an ordering of our lives that are going to count and be used effectively, you know, for the Lord. So this is what Numbers has been doing and what has been taking place during our time of studying through, telling us that the Lord wants an accounting, a linkage. And if we're going to be the people that we're supposed to be, then we need to have this accountability. And so chapter 28, bearing in mind the application being, how can we make our lives count? He now in this section begins to reiterate the sacrifices. Last time we mentioned about the sweet savior offering and the different offerings that would be practiced, if you would. How that when the flesh and the savor offering, the smoke offering or the burnt offering, but it would, the flesh is burning in the nostrils, so to speak, of God. And that smoke that's burning, it comes out, is not pleasant to us. But to Him, we're told, it's sweet. It's delightful to Him because it sets you and I free. The flesh is what slows you down and me down and holds us back. So when the flesh is being consumed, the Father said, this is delightful to me because it will set you free. And it will allow you to see me, the Father would say. But we know that no man can see the God, the Father, and live. The flesh can't glory in His presence. If we are going to be a group of people who experience the presence of God, then the flesh has to be dealt with, our old crummy flesh. And how important it is for us to say to God, Lord, I know that it needs to die. Letting go of, of the flesh, a dying of the flesh needs to take place in order for us to see God's face. Someone has to die. And not just receive from your hand the blessing of God, but to really be in the place where I'm experiencing His presence. Not just presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S, gifts, but the presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E, the giver. Not just the gift, but the giver. And so now we get and we find ourselves back into the offerings. In chapter 28, verse 3 and 4, and you shall, and we're gonna not do every single verse. We'll cover, because it's again, like I said, reiterating and repetitive. But you'll get enough of the gist of what's going on to understand. And you shall say to them, verse 3 says, this is the offering made by fire which you shall offer to the Lord. Two male lambs in the first year without blemish, day by day as a regular burnt offering. The one lamb you shall offer in the morning, the other lamb you shall offer in the evening. And then if you jump to verse 9, it says, and on the Sabbath day, add two lambs in their first year without blemish, and two-tenths of an ephah of flour, fine flour, as a grain offering. Mix it with oil with its drink offering. And so now you have four lambs on the Sabbath day, two in the morning, two in the evening, so that the Sabbath day was different because the sacrifice doubles. And a greater energy and effort is expended by the priest when they do these offerings, usually just a lamb in the morning and one in the evening, but on the Sabbath, two and two. And then besides that, notice with me verse 11, it says, at the beginnings of your months, you shall present a burnt offering to the Lord, two young bulls, one ram, and seven lambs in their first year that are without blemish. And some of the meal offerings are mentioned as well. So at the first of the year, again it increases, two bullocks, one ram, seven lambs on top of that. So that every day, that every day lamb in the morning and at night, on the Sabbath, every seventh day it doubles. Then the first of each month, a special burnt offering is given. So 2 plus 7, and you've got bullocks and rams, and it's a whole menagerie. Verse 16, on the 15th day of the first month is the Passover of the Lord. And so annually comes the Passover. What's the Passover celebrate? Basically how God delivered the people of Israel from the bondage there in Egypt and set them free. And the Passover, we have seen, points to Jesus. It speaks of Him, the Lamb of God who was killed on what day? On Passover. At the very time that the national sacrifice would be being made, Christ was on the cross dying for our sin. And so what then you would have is you have this annual convocation, a Passover commemoration and celebration, all of this pointing to Jesus Christ. And then on the next day, verse 17, and on the 15th day of this month is the feast, unleavened bread shall be eaten for 7 days. Another feast, no leavened bread was used or to be eaten. It was also pointing to Jesus Christ. Why? Because leaven is a type of sin. And Jesus died on the Passover. He was buried on the unleavened bread celebration day. And what that means is if there was leaven in Him, if there was sin in Him, then He would not have risen again. Again, the proof that He is who He claimed to be. He is God in the flesh, perfection personified, having no sin. Death could not hold Him. And so He was buried on the day of unleavened bread. And then 3 days after Passover, verse 26, also on the day of the first fruits, when you bring a new grain offering to the Lord at your feast of weeks, you shall have a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work. And so 3 days after the Passover was the convocation, the festival or the feast of first fruits, Christ died on the Passover, was buried during the unleavened bread festival, and rose again in the festival of first fruits. This took place 3 days later. And who rose again on the fest of first fruits? It was Jesus Christ, the first fruit, the first one who has risen from the dead to never die again. He is the first fruits and first fruit, and we will follow Him soon. Now, that's the proper structure of chapter 28, and you've got the high points. Now, in chapter 28 and chapter 29, we'll look at chapter 29 next week. But if you read it, you found that it is, as we've already mentioned, basically a reiteration of what took place in the book of Leviticus. It deals with holy days, festivals, sacrifices, and all these things that were to be part of the worship. Now, you might think, okay, why is it being repeated again? And not only that, you might think, Joe, are you going to go through it again like in Leviticus? Well, is Leviticus really that bad? No. Let me just say this, though, for you that are looking for some relief. We won't do that. But there's some things that we need to remember. And here's what we need to remember. Keep in mind, first of all, you're dealing with a new generation, right? That old generation, 40 years, it's gone. And so those that are receiving this instruction are different than the ones that received instructions then at the time they were given back in the book of Leviticus. That generation that received those instructions has died off. And so here's a new generation. And new generations need to be reminded and taught carefully. Not rush through it, not push it and shove it down their throats. But there needed to be a careful reiteration, a careful teaching, and a careful reminder. Sometimes, I don't know about you, but I find it hard, especially when they were younger, but even so much, even now, there are times that I have a real hard time connecting with my kids. especially when it comes to things of the Bible. I remember one time having a long conversation with my kids, and they were asking questions and why we did things the way we did them, and why this had to be this way and that way and so on and so forth. And I started explaining to them, as I usually did at that time, and I usually do now, but explained to them through Scripture why we do what we do, and not just say, because I said so. That doesn't work. But to share scriptural principles, precepts, truths that they can stand upon. And so this connection with my kids, it was funny because after we had gotten deep into this conversation for a while, I think it was Josh looked at me and he said, "Dad, why do you always have to answer with Scripture?" Thank you, Josh. You know, because it's true. It's not that you want to beat him with the Bible or anything like that, but he's the life, the truth, the life, and the way. And no one comes unto the Father but by him. But he is the truth. He is the life, and he is the way. What better place to seek out answers than where the truth is given? And so it made all the sense in the world to me, but not so much to them. And to a certain degree, they kind of resented the fact that I was always using the Bible to answer the questions that they had. But here, Israel needs the same stance concerning the things of God regarding this generation. They needed to be reminded. And when the reminder I'm talking about is the reminder that I'm sure came from the parents that were being killed off, that had to learn that lesson the hard way. But as they listened and they listened and they listened, then taking that as their children got older and instilling it upon them over and over again, the things that were taught in the tabernacle, taught in the temple. This new generation needed to learn it. The point to all of this is, and you know, even not even the complex things, but some of the simpler things they need to hear. And sometimes you're thinking that you're just talking, "Well, son, well, daughter, Jesus loves you. This I know, because the Bible tells you so." And to risk your kid looking at you like, "Are you starting to lose it?" You know, not that they don't know that you love the Lord, but they're in that phase, if you would. And you know, I kind of thought about this, that it, again, like I said, it was a blessing that they recognized that I depended on something other than myself for answers to the questions that they have. And so it would have been easy for them to look at this and said, "You know what, they've learned all this stuff already. Why are they acting this way and doing this thing?" And the point is that we need to reiterate, even within our own life sometimes, but to reestablish some fundamental principles. These guys weren't around when Moses was giving out all these instructions. You kind of think about it in terms of when you come across some snotty-nosed kid who's being disrespectful. And sometimes we can think someone's just being rude, grumpy, or whatever. But in reality, maybe they don't speak English. No English. And it's really easy for someone to make, like us, a judgment without realizing what's happening underneath or behind the scenes. It's easy for us to look at kids and make judgments without realizing that they perhaps haven't been taught a language. We need to take every generation and instruct and refreshed him in the basics. And he saw the transition that took place from when Pastor Chuck was around teaching the hippies, and then the hippies growing up, who knows what they became? Old hippies, I guess. But they also needed to be teachers and passing things on. And so it's really easy to make a judgment without realizing what's going on. And it's easy for us to look at kids and make judgments without realizing, you know, things about them. Last Monday and Tuesday, we hosted the Blue Devils. And we hosted the A Corps, the B Corps, and the C Corps for a class on ethics, which was interesting. But as Britt said, they were basically teaching the Bible without the chapter and verse, because the principles are all found in there. But here, you know, again, if you look at these kids, they broke Bob's desk, his little desk that he sits on. Curse you, kids. No. But, you know, you kind of look at that and you just go, what is up with you guys? And they're just a little rambunctious, I think, you know, partially. But there's that issue of disrespect and respectability. But it's really easy on our part to make a judgment and say, what a jerk that kid is, because he broke things disrespectfully without understanding what's going on underneath. And it's easy for us to look at the kids and make judgment, like I said, without realizing that. And so we need to take every generation and instruct and refresh them in the basics. And so that's what's happening here in chapter 28 and 29. Now, jumping backwards just for a second, I want you to look at verses 1 and 2 in chapter 28. It says, "Now the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, command the children of Israel, and say to them, my offering, my food for my offering, made by fire, as a sweet aroma to me, you shall be careful to offer to me at their appointed time. This is what is sweet to me, the Lord says. This is what is pleasurable to me, that is delightful for me. And that is when you bring these sweet savior offerings, these burnt offerings, when you offer them to me, the Lord would say, it is delightful. It is my bread and my food. When you burn that on the altar, the Lord would say, it is pleasant to me. Now, here's what's interesting. If you've ever smelt burnt bull or burnt of any animal, I'm not talking about the smoker. I'm not talking about the barbecue in the backyard. But I'm talking about the hide, the hair, the whole bull. When the hide and the hair burns, guess what? It stinks. It stinks to high heaven. It's putrid. The burning of flesh stinks. And yet God says, from my perspective, God's perspective, the burning of flesh is sweet. For you, maybe it stinks. But to me, the Lord would say, it is a sweet-smelling offering. Whenever the flesh is placed upon the altar, it is always sweet in the nostrils of our Father. The flesh. Most of you guys know that the flesh in the Bible speaks of our inclination towards selfishness, towards sinful tendencies, towards the flesh. And God says that when it is placed on the altar, when it is eradicated, when it is destroyed, and when it is consumed, that is sweet to the Lord. There's nothing sweeter to God than when I lay my flesh, when you lay your flesh on the altar and let it burn. Nothing sweeter. It's sweet to God for two reasons, if you want to mark these down. First reason is it sets me free. God knows that my fleshly attitudes and my fleshly tendencies are going to crimp me. They're going to restrict me. And they're going to make me small, and you small, and miserable. God knows all about that. He knows what the flesh does to us. He understands. He sees clearly and he knows thoroughly that yes, when you indulge your flesh, it's pleasurable. There's pleasure in sin for a season, the Bible says. And then comes judgment or destruction. And God says, whenever I see the burning flesh, it's sweet to me because I know that whoever is offering it up is being set free. To the degree that I am not in the flesh will be the degree that I am free and happy and at peace. For to be carnally minded is death. Romans 8, verse 6 tells us. Carnally minded. Carnal, guys, simply means flesh. Chili con carnal. Okay? So the flesh. And Romans chapter 8, verse 6 says to be carnally minded is death. This is how to just be dead. And you can look at people and there's just a deadness in their eyes when they're taken over by this. A deadness on their face. The joy that was once there is not there anymore. The enthusiasm is no longer there. Just a deadness. Why? Because it's the flesh. They've given in to the flesh. They've succumbed to the flesh. And they're caught up with their flesh. The Bible says, and God says, to be carnally minded is death. But, there's one of those famous, but God. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So do you want to live? Do you want to have peace? Do you want to put your head on the pillow tonight and fall asleep immediately? Do you want to have life abundantly? Then don't be fleshly. Put on the altar, the flesh. Put the flesh on the altar, guys. Stop feeding your flesh and focusing on how you feel or on your thing or on your pain, your hurt, or your need. Whatever it might be, and rather be spiritually minded, the Bible says. This is something that is so important for us to wrap our arms around, to grab a hold of. People are basically needlessly unhappy because they're in the flesh. Mad about this, mad about that, mad about being wronged. To the degree that to be carnally minded is death. To be spiritually minded when you're in the Spirit, it's life and it's peace and it sets me free. When I let my flesh be consumed. And then secondly, it lets me see what? It lets me see God. You see, no flesh in the Scriptures say, shall glory in my presence, saith the Lord. If I'm in the flesh, I can't see the Lord. I'm caught up in me, analyzing people, analyzing ministries constantly. And guess what? It gets ugly fast. But he says, no flesh shall glory in my presence. I've got to let the flesh die. You see, Moses desperately desired this Moses that we're talking about. He desperately desired to see God. What he wanted was the presence of God. That's what Moses desired, the presence of God, passionately. And he said to God, if your presence doesn't go with me, I don't want to go on this journey to the land of promise. Moses didn't want his hand, that is, just his gifts. He wanted God's face. And there's a difference that they spell out for us tonight. He didn't want something from God, something tangible, something material, something that he could pick up and take with him as a present, you would. He didn't want his hand, he wanted his face. He didn't want the blessing on his family necessarily, or on his business, or whatever it might have been. He wanted God. And it's not about Moses being the big leader, leading this congregation, being successful in the eyes of men, going down in history. Those weren't the things that were important to him, that might be important to any number of people any other time. No, he didn't want that. What he wanted was God's presence. And Moses said, if you don't go with me, I don't want to go. I don't care, Father, how big the ministry might be. I'm not concerned about how successful I might be or be known as and go down in history. To Moses, it was irrelevant. It was unimportant. It wasn't satisfactory. Moses would say, I want to see you, God. I want to see you. And here's the deal, guys. Whether or not you're aware of it, or whether you know it or not, what we all are craving is the face of God. But the way that we often live is, Lord, I don't care about your face, just give me your hand. Just give me a provision. Give me things. And we have a tendency to be concentrated on the hand and what is given to us by the hand. That is, give me this, touch that, anoint the other, bless that. Give me that and work this out and open this door and bring that about and make it happen. And it's all about the hand. Father, make me faithful, please. So often with us, it's, Lord, my business is in trouble. Lord, my kids need your touch, or I can't pay the bills. Not feeling very good, Lord. You see, we seek his hand. That is what he gives, not who he is. We're seeking what he gives and not who he is. The problem with that is that once you get whatever's in his hand, it's never enough. Whatever it is that you're asking for from his hand, when it comes your way, it doesn't do what you thought it would do. It doesn't bring the joy and the happiness that you thought it would. And it doesn't really matter if it relates to ministry. It can relate to good things, or it relates to family. Any number of good things, but it just doesn't do what you thought it would do. Moses understood this. It's not about your hand. It is about your face. I want to see your face. I want to be in your presence. Not a touch from you, Lord. Not an anointing. That's not what I'm seeking. You see, what the anointing can do when you're seeking it. Lord, bless my music. Lord, bless the preaching, or this thing or that thing. Bless the business. What anointing can do is create spiritual pornography. And let me tell you what I mean by that. It creates fan clubs. It creates a situation where you're just a spectator, where you're just a groupie. Some healing evangelist goes from stadium to stadium, and people do whatever they can do, even if it's stretching the truth to get a front row ticket. To do what? To watch somebody else's intimacy, someone else's anointing. We want the front row seat, so we'll cut in line or we'll make up a story to get up in the front. To do what? To watch somebody else, to hear them in music and ministry and whatever. Think about this, guys. I'm not putting the nicks on all the concerts you go and maybe perhaps see, or the things that you go to and you're really blessed by, or the speakers and so on and so forth. But there is a question for you, and that is, what is your desire? What do you want to be? What do you want to do? Do you want the hand? Just the provision? That's okay. It's not a bad thing. Unless, well, we'll see here. But it's maybe perhaps not the best thing. We need to find out what the Lord wants of us. What his heart is for us. But this creates a situation, this whole way of doing things, where you're just a spectator and a groupie. Some healing evangelist goes from stadium to stadium. People do whatever they can to watch someone else's intimacy and someone else's anointing. To watch somebody else, to hear them in music and ministry, or other kinds of ministry, or whatever it was would be. To see the anointing, we want to see God's touch on that man or on that group of musicians. But there's something much more important than the anointing, and it's called the presence of God. And when the presence of God is in its place, when you're in his presence, look and see what 2 Chronicles chapter 7 says. It says that when the presence of God filled the temple, it says the priests, the ones on stage, the ones who were anointed, it says that they couldn't even stand to minister. They couldn't even make it to the platform. Why? Because the presence of God was in the place. Everyone was in awe. Everyone was caught up and amazed. Why? Because the presence of God. It was the face of God, not the hand of God, touching someone or some group. It was the presence of God that filled the temple. And the priest, it says, couldn't even stand to minister. I don't know if they were shaken. I don't know if they just, their ability to bear weight went out of their legs or what it was. But they couldn't even stand to minister. They could not make it to the platform. And you know what? It didn't matter. Because the presence of God was there, powerful. And there was satisfaction, not a spiritual pornography thing where you're watching somebody else spiritually intimate, but rather the whole congregation was experiencing the presence of God, not just the priest, the whole congregation. And Moses understood this, and he said, Lord, I want to see your face. I want your presence. I don't care about ministry, Moses would say. I don't care about my place in history. I don't care about anything else, but I need your face. I need your presence. Now here's the trick. God then said to Moses, Mo, got a problem. You guys know what the problem was? No man can see me and live. Moses, do you realize what you're asking? You see, Moses, you want to see me. You want my face, and then you've got to understand something. You're going to die. And Moses said, that's what I want. And the Lord said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put you in the cleft of this rock and put my hand over you, and I'll pass by you, and you can see my afterglow. But Moses, the only way that you can see me in my glory is if and when you die. And by the way, when did Moses see the glory of the Lord shining? As you know, it was incredible. What? Yeah, Matthew chapter 17, the Mount of Transfiguration. But Moses was dead, you see. Alive, but he had died. So what am I saying? Well, here's a challenge for you and a challenge for me. Yes, Lord, we want your presence. Everybody here want the presence of God? May it be that the kabod, the Shekinah, the glory fills this room, fills this congregation, fills our family. That's what we need. May the presence of God move into this place. But God says, are you sure that's what you want? Are you absolutely positive? Because you've got to die. And to the degree that you die, Joe, will be the degree that you experience my glory, my presence, and my face. Are you willing to die? And so God would say here at this juncture, are you sure that's what you want, Joe, for Calvary Chapel? Are you sure you want me to come in? There in chapter 2 of John, Jesus would say, I turned over tables. It got messy. People were upset. It was brutal. And they left the church. And they went somewhere else. They went to another church. Why? Because tables were overturned, because cattle were driven out, and because people made their living that way, it upset them. They thought they were in a religious ministry. And okay, doing the things that they were doing. But Jesus said, hey, don't make my Father's house a den of thieves. It's to be what? A house of prayer for all nations. That's what we're talking about when we're trying to get different prayer points and platforms in place for this church. So that you can, I mean, we've talked even about putting chairs, stools out in the parking lot and having pull-up prayer time that we can pray for people as they come through. We want to put together a Zoom time of prayer, things that we're working on currently, so we can get this fellowship, this body of believers, to be prayer warriors. Amen. Even with Stand for Israel prayer. All these things are designed to meet that need. And so the presence of God, it's linked to the death of my flesh. But the flesh has got to die. We're back to that. The question is, do I really want that? Or am I going to say, Lord, I think I'll pass on the face thing. That's a little creepy to me. Just give me the hand, as if that's not a little weird. But just give me the hand because I just want my business blessed. I just want the kids doing well. But God. Or should I say, been there, done that. That's great, but that's not enough. Lord, I want your presence. The hand's not enough. I want your face. Joe, no man can see me and live. It means that all that flesh is going to have to be consumed on the altar. It means that it's going to stink the high heavens. It's going to stink in the nostrils of people. But to me, it's going to be sweet. People are going to say to you, why are you doing that? It's not clean. It's not logical. It's not reasonable. Why would you want to go to prayer meetings, give up your time to serve? What's wrong with just Sunday morning church every now and then? And isn't that where we're at right now today? We got a whole group that are just in that category of, let's just do prayer meetings Sunday morning. But there is another group that wants the presence. And for many, there's nothing wrong with Sunday morning church now and then. What's wrong, though, with just being regulated in your involvement? And the answer to that is because, Lord, I realize that my flesh has got to be dealt with. I know what happens that when I'm home, it's easy to watch TV and plop on the couch, feed my flesh. Easy to pamper my flesh and feed it and focus on it. Easy. And it's the tendency of my fleshly nature. I know that. And so I need to go to the altar to be on my face, to see your face. It means I need to deal with sin and sloth and junk. It means I need to rearrange my life. It means that tables are going to be overturned and that some things need to be driven out. It means that he must increase and I must decrease. There's the greatest man, Jesus said, of all, none greater. Not Moses, not David, not Isaiah. There's none greater than John the Baptist. But John did no miracles. But John understood that he must increase or he must decrease, but Jesus must increase and he must decrease. That's the key to greatness. The flesh has to be dealt with. We can no longer be seeking after the hand, but rather the face. It means it's going to stink in the eyes of others. Why are you going to church again to pray? Come on. The football game's on. The baseball's going on. Giants and A's are playing. The Father says, it's sweet to me. I love it. Burning flesh. So do we want his anointing? Or do we want his presence? What if the musician said, I don't care about the anointing. I just want the presence. So that if I ever make it to the platform, it doesn't matter at all. You see, it's not about that. Let me just come and sit in the back corner, lift my hands up and sing my heart out and let no one see my flesh. Let no one applaud my song or say, hey, that was great. Thank you. Praise the Lord. But how are they going to hear the talent that I have? How are they going to know how gifted I am if I'm not on the platform? Do you want my hand or do you want my face? Lord, I want your face. No flesh shall glory in my presence. No man can see me and live. Your choice. I'll take you as far as you want to go. And isn't that the truth with our Lord? He will take you as far as you want to go. If you want my hand, I'll give that to you. But if you want my face, when the presence of the Lord filled the temple, the priests couldn't stand, couldn't make it to the platform. The presence of God was in the place. And this applies to every area. And so I realize, Lord, I have been one who has truly asked for your presence. Then no wonder that the tables are overturned. No wonder things are getting a little bit messy. That I feel like I'm dying. It's the only way, isn't it, Lord? It's the only way. Why? Because no flesh shall glory in your presence. No man shall see you and live. And so, Lord, send the fire. We sing that, don't we? Preach it. Say it. Guys, the Lord never sends fire to the altar unless there's flesh on the altar. He won't send the fire if the altar's empty. Look at this altar we're burning. Structure, polished, beautiful. This beautiful building. He's not impressed until you're on top of it. Look how well I can play. But Lord, I'm going to get burned. I hear people say that all the time. I got burned. Perfect. Excellent. Because you see, that's what it's all about. Fried. Smell the noise. Because you see, that's sweet to him. Because your flesh is finally being burnt away, and now you'll see something of my face. And then at last you'll have the satisfaction that you've been seeking from my hand, from ministry, family, blessing, business, whatever. But it's never there, is it? As good as those things are, it doesn't satisfy my soul. Only you can, Lord. And I've got to see you. Then you've got to die. That's the only way. Or you can be a spectator. Go to all these places, listen to all the others, learn from others and all, but it will be like pornography. You're watching someone else's intimacy. It's not your own. God declares to a new generation, this new generation that's coming in the journey and getting ready to go into the promised land. He says, this is what I desire. This is what I really want. The burning of the flesh. Getting rid of your personality, your charisma, your talent, your abilities, your anointing. And then watch and see what I can do, Joe. At Calvary, in your home, in your own soul. Would be to God that we would crave that passionately. Excuse me. Can you say, I want more of God in my life? I want his face. I've had his hand and I'm thankful. But increasingly I want his presence, his face, to fill my heart, my home, this church. I realize that there's a price to pay. The flesh has got to die. Now you say, wait a minute, Joe. Here you are on the platform. And I realize that that needs to happen. But I will say this. In studying for this, I found myself thinking that it's so freeing to say, help me, Lord, to find ways in which I'm not seeking or desiring the spotlight or the limelight. I'll fulfill the responsibilities that you've given to me. I understand that. I'll use the gifts that you've given to me, but Lord, it's not where my heart is primarily. I think it would be great if the prayer meeting was the biggest meeting we had, or the special times of ministry that we have would be the greatest attended. I look forward to the time when the presence of God is such that people just do anything to be a part of it, even though it costs them everything. It doesn't come from listening to the latest Christian CD or going to the latest seminar, or last concert, or convention. It comes when the flesh dies. Comes when a husband and a wife and a family or a congregation say, Lord, we want your presence. We want your face. We'll call upon you. Lay down our lives before you. We'll give up everything that we have held previously as being important as it relates to ministry, business, family, whatever. Whatever it takes, whatever it means. And the Lord would say, are you sure you want that? And do you know what you're saying? Because you see, no man can see me and live. I've walked with him for many years, been in ministry a long time, but I do want more of the Lord, because I know that's the only thing that will satisfy any man or any woman's soul. It's the presence of God. And it's really doable if I'm willing to die. So guys, really ask the Lord, what am I really all about? What am I about? What am I after? What do I desire? Your hand or your face? Honestly. What if the Lord came to you and said, what if God said your business will prosper greatly, your kids will do well, your family's going to be blessed, and I'm going to bless you with this and give you these things. It's yours. Or you can die and have my presence, what would you honestly say? I mean, I know what the right answer is. Ooh, ooh, pick me. I know, I know. Give me the presence. But don't be surprised when you start to die, when people start killing you, and things start shriveling up, and things don't work out, and you go, Lord, what is going on? I thought I asked you for my presence. I did, Lord. Well, this is the way that that happens. When your flesh is annihilated, eradicated, sizzling, frying, burning. And Joe, Brian, Misa, Ruth, if you hang in with me and let it happen, here's what you'll get: my presence. You'll see my face. If you choose not to, I'll bless you. I'll keep my hand upon you. I'll give this to you and provide that for you. I do that too. But listen, guys, God will take you as deep as you want to go, but not one inch deeper. It's all up to you. And it works out really practically, because the rest of the chapter, he says, here's what happens daily. A lamb in the morning, a lamb in the evening, you sacrifice it. And on the Sabbath day, you sacrifice four lambs. And then the first of the month, you give a greater offering. And it goes on and on and on. And guess what? You can't outgive God. He uses this word 17 times in chapters 28 and 29. Either regular or continual. 17 times in these two chapters, he uses the word regular or continual. Continual burnt offerings. Continual, regular. Are you regular? It's a good question for you, for us. Regular or irregular? Well, you know, it's hard. I need my sleep, you know. Well, it's a long drive. Worked hard. Kids got stuff. Be careful, guys, that it's not the flesh. Let it fry. You see, when you read the chapters, you see where the Lord is taking the whole discussion. It's a continual burnt offering. It is to be regular. It is to be edifying. It is to be building up. So much so that when you come to the end of the chapters, you have over a ton of flour that's been given. 1 ton. 1,000 gallons of wine and oil. 13,000 oxen. 60,000 sheep. This was annually. Man. That's an awful lot of giving. It's a big sacrifice. Think back to younger father's days. My kids were little. Came up to me, I think, Caleb, can I have $10 to get you a gift? Sure. And you give him $10 to get me a gift. And so he makes a card, and inside, voila, is a $10 bill. So I tell him, thank you, Caleb. Now, I gave the money so that I could sacrifice it, that he could sacrifice it and give it to me. But man, when God says thousands of oxen, lambs and gallons and tons, and that's a lot. But wait a minute. God has to give it to them before they can give it back. For them to give that kind of sacrifice, it means that God has to give that to them in the first place. Or they can't do it what God has told them to do. One kid one time gave a book that would already, it was his book. Took it from the bookshelf and he wrapped it up and he gave it to me. You say, we say that this is so hard to do, but God gives to us all that we have, all that we are. He's a giver. And if I lay down my life and I say, take away whatever you gave me initially, ministry opportunities, talent, friendship, whatever. Lord, you gave that to me in the first place. So I give it to you knowing that you gave it to me, because if I give it to you, you're not going to be outgiving by me, because you can't outgive God. That's a principle of the Father. So when I talk of this idea of the altar and sacrifice, understand this. You are you're incapable of outgiving God. I'll never be on the altar sizzling and say, what a bummer, because the blessings that will come back my way, the presence of God, will be so elating, satisfying, and wonderful that I'll say, where have I been, and why have I been holding back and consumed with his hand and not seeking his face? And I'm not talking about what is going on in many churches today. This is, it deals with dying to our flesh. David was a man after God's own heart. That doesn't mean David had a heart like God's, but rather it means that David was after God's heart. He wanted nothing but God's heart. He went after God's heart. That's why he was the one who leapt over walls and killed giants and was king of Israel and was the friend of God. He was after God's heart. He didn't care about the giant deal, the harp playing, or being king of the land. That was all incidental. Who cares? What he wanted, David did. He wanted God's heart. He wanted God's face. He wanted God's presence. I so badly want this for each of us, on a home level, a soul level, on a church level. But it needs to be pursued. Not that you're working for it, because that's not what it's about. But you need to move in the right direction. You need to seek the Lord and ask him to check out your life, your schedule, your activity, your priorities. Where does the flesh need to be placed on the altar? It does. It needs to be a place where no flesh glories in his presence. Father, help us, Lord, just to meditate on these things, not to come to a conclusion right away. Maybe listen again. Look at notes, if any were taken. But Lord, let me search, see if there be anything within me that would prevent this. That Father could be turned over to you, submitted to you, and placed upon that altar. And Lord, may we be those that seek your presence with the full understanding of what takes place and what that means. May we be seekers of your presence passionately. Hunger and thirsty after you. We ask it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.